architecture is really the art and science of turning fiction into fact.
Sometimes kind of real architectural life interferes with intellectual architectural life.
There is no such thing as architecture.
Hello everyone, this is Vikram Prakash and you are yet once again listening to Architecture Talk. It's early March 2022 and in very complex and difficult circumstances around the world. We continue to have our conversations with architectural thinkers trying to think about the state of architecture and architectural thinking. Today I'm having a conversation with my friend Richard Williams, who's Professor of Art History at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland. And what we are talking about mostly is his recent book on the life and work of the well-known architectural historian and theorist, Reyner Banham. Richard Williams, if you remember from my earlier conversation with his big book on sex and architecture, is an original out-of-the-box thinker. And that is, I think, the reason why he was attracted to the work of Reyner Banham, whom he describes as a person who could think of radical ideas in plain sight and who lived a life that was quite extraordinary and well beyond his well-known and well-published books. I hope you enjoy this conversation. Here we go.
Let's talk about your book on Reyner Banham. And I see that, as usual in your usual way, it's not just a reading of his writings. It's really a reading of the man and his life and his progress through time. And as you put it, his multiple identities, right? I mean, you have this seven Banhams.
Yeah.
You have the futurist, the brutalist, the autophile, the environmentalist, the Angelino, the desert freak, and the connoisseur of ruins.
Yeah.
What's going on here? Start with first telling us, you know, why Banham? You know, as far as I know, this is the only book you are like on a single figure that you've
read. It is. It is. To be honest, I mean, I'll tell you the anecdotal version of it to begin with. I mean, is that I was actually contracted to write something else. I was trying to write a book on theories of creativity and the city, and I was completely stuck. I couldn't. It wasn't going anywhere. It was too big a project, and I realized I went to the AAG, the Geographers Conference in Chicago.
Yeah.
And there were about 6,000 people there all doing exactly that. And I thought, I can't possibly compete with them. And so I did have some money from the Getty to go into the library and actually do a short piece on Banham, like just do a book chapter or an article, I forget what it was.
Yeah.
And so I went through the whole of the Banham archive there, which actually is not that big, but I did think, having spent a couple of weeks in the archive, I thought, there was scope to do another book on Banham. And I think what I felt with him was that, I'd taught his material very often for 20 years, more than that, really. And students had often enjoyed it. It was, always good discussion after it. But in terms of finding a good text that made sense of him for them, or for people who are perhaps outside of the field of architecture, in a sense there wasn't that much. I mean, I think there's lots of wonderful accounts of Banham out there, and very serious research. I mean, Nigel Whiteley's book, is a huge piece of research, very impressive. But it's difficult to kind of use that. So I think what I wanted to do with the idea of revisiting him was to think about the use value of what he did. Was he just somebody of his time, or were there things in there that you could rethink, reuse, mm-hmm. return to. And that was fundamentally the idea.
But is that the book you have written in the end? Is like, how is this relevant to today? I mean, the sense I get a little bit from the book is, this is the Banham you did not know about.
When I was thinking about how to organize it, then I wanted to write something about him as a figure, you know, as a human being. I mean, not necessarily in a traditional biographical sense, but in the sense that he was somebody who constructed a public a persona for himself, you know. So, you know, as well as being an academic, an architectural historian, and you know, critic, whatever, he's somebody who's pushing himself out into the public realm. He's doing a lot of TV and radio and things that make him a public figure. He's doing a lot of that, you know, before that was a regular thing to do for somebody. Yeah.
So what was that about? Why was he doing that? And what's your reading about that?
I think there's simply a theatrical element that runs all the way through, you know. I mean, right from an early age. Well, one of his first jobs is working in a theatre. And he's in a kind of amateur way, he's interested in performance. You know, he's interested in projecting himself, and you know, the kind of figures that he often alights on, I mean, who writes about, are themselves quite theatrical figures. Mm. So I think he's got, without really theorizing it in a structured way, I think he has quite a theatrical understanding of the world. So it's about performance a lot of the time. Now, I mean, in terms of, you know, where that comes from exactly, what it means, you know, some of it, I think, is just he's around people who are like that as well, you know, from an early age. But I think there's something else, and it's I'm certainly not the only person to say it. I think Tony Vidler is somebody who's alighted on this, and that thing is class, it's social class, and that. There's something in a lot of what he does that makes you conscious of him having different registers and different voices, and you know, having to be in public in different ways. And I think if you come from a relatively kind of low class background, as Banham did, then that is something that you would habitually do. You know, you're constantly having to put on a particular kind of voice or make appear in public in a particular way in order to be taken seriously. And yet at the same time, you know, you have other voices which you use in other places. And I think he's acutely conscious of that. So there is in the writing, for example, there is stuff that he explicitly regarded as serious, and you know, that would be other books for the most part, but you know, particularly something like Theory and Design in the First Machine, PhD, all of that. So you know, regards that's the serious work.
Yeah,
and then there's all the other stuff.
All the other stuff.
But I think what's interesting, I suppose, is that you know, often the other stuff is actually very serious. It's just it's in a different voice. So I think like a lot of figures of his generation, you know, in all sorts of fields, he's somebody who's conscious of having to have different voices and speaking to different publics. And
that's one of the things that attracted you to him? I mean, you have a pretty strong, in the age of social media, good public presence through your Twitter feeds and you know, you sit beautifully at the intersection of art history, architectural history, public culture, kind of global culture, transformative thinking, intersectionality. I mean, you're kind of a maverick intellectual yourself, are you not?
Yeah, In terms of the media stuff, I've never gone anything like as far as, you know, I haven't even approached anything remotely like what Banham did.
Are you comparing yourself, or you're saying that's not how you are?
Well, I think he's of an entirely different order. But in terms of his interest in reaching a broader public, and is this address to a broader
beyond,
public?
Beyond us academics? Yes, I mean
That is attractive, and I have to say that I think, you know, one of the appeals of doing the book was actually because I'd always found his most public work to be the most powerful, and actually kind of at its best, you know, kind of model for it. And of course, as a model, it doesn't fit well with academic game playing now, you know, or the institutional games at all. And I hope we don't completely lose that from academic life. But I mean, I think, you know, certainly the idea that an attractive way to sort of be in public is to have this broader address. I mean, that's something that I think is important. You know, somebody needs to do it. You know, some people.
I mean, the idea of a public intellectual is extremely attractive to me too. I mean, I have no idea how to do it.
No.
You know, I don't think I'm anywhere near being that kind of a person. You are definitely more.
Well, no, I don't do a little bit, but I mean, I think things have very, you know, decisively moved on in the last few years anyway, with social media and, you know, the way that, like, younger academics, people who are using social media, like, really well now, I mean, they're doing extraordinary things, which, you know, way beyond this. But yeah, I mean, it was an attraction to deal with a figure who was a public intellectual like that. And also, you know, I wanted to, I suppose for readers who, you know, might be students, or, you know, there might be us or whoever, I wanted to say that some of the writing that was superficially the least serious was actually the most serious. And that, you know, it might be a 700-word article for New Society was something that had the most kind of destabilizing, or, you know, unsettling or provoking ideas in it. And I would stick by that. I think often his best writing is the shortest.
So what was his position or provocation as a public intellectual? I mean, let's leave theory and design
aside. Yeah, let's put that aside. I think there are various provocations. I think one is that often there are very radical things hidden in plain sight. That, you know, as intellectuals, as academics, we often are finding things which are extremely obscure. But in fact, often the most destabilizing technologies or ideas are the things that are just simply there. And so, you know, for example, you know, the core book of all of them is the Los Angeles book, I think. And it's the way that he would pull out something like a hamburger stand, and then, you know, do a kind of architectural take on the design of the hamburger and its evolution from a sort of functional object into a kind of thing. And it's sort of fantastic, you know, and it's the idea that you have this ubiquitous object, you know, consumed by millions every day, and it's just, you know, and yet it, you know, it represents something that's profoundly sort of radical in some ways. I'm completely with him there. You know, I mean, you need to take these things seriously, you know, even if you're ostensibly making a joke out of them. So I think that's the, for me, it's the radical proposition of Banham is his looking at things which are just there, you know, in plain sight, and saying, oh, we should take these things seriously, you know, even if they're bad taste, or you know, we think we ought not to be looking at them, but they're important. So, you know, what we know, what he does with car design is important as well. And then, you know, also, and I particularly like what he does with driving as a technology and as a way of looking at the world. I mean, that, you know, that now, of course, is full of problems and questions and things which are unsettling, but, you know, it's very very kind of interesting what he does there.
Right. So how was all this, tell us, how was all this received in his time?
That's an interesting question, isn't it? I mean, he was a relentless self-promoter. I mean, fantastic at it. And I think, you know, he's extremely good at getting attention and getting reviews of books and all of that. I think there is, you know, on the one hand, there are the early moment, you know, 50s and 60s. I think he's somebody who articulates things about modernism and about brutalism, which put him really in a vanguard position. And, you know, he's in the right place at the right time. He's right. Talking to the right architects. He's providing a theory of brutalism. He tells you about futurism for the first time and makes sense. And I think, you know, those things have a very, you know, broadly very positive critical perception. Then there's this moment where he starts to go to the United States.
Mm.
And I think at that point, you know, he starts to become a more difficult figure. I think, you know, he loses some people along the way. Like, I mean, I know but Kenneth Frampton, for example, is somebody who, you know, they're close and more aligned in some way at the beginning. But then as soon as Banham discovers California, Frampton's no longer interested. And it's a fascinating moment there. So I think he loses people there, but also he also becomes more successful in terms of the media. So, you know, he has a more public presence like that. But he perhaps loses the architecture folks to an extent. And then the work, in a way, becomes more eccentric as it goes on. And I mean that also was an appeal. And I must say I'm a kind of later Banham rather than the early Banham.
I
find more intriguing. But, you know, he starts doing things, you know, in some ways very anachronistic, or they're very hostile to the architectural establishment, or at least, you know, from time to time, like the architecture of the well-tempered environment, you know, has a little go at the architecture, architectural establishment and its refusal to think about technology. But then, you know, there are things which are oddly anachronistic and out of time, and it's a funny career, and it sort of goes from the centre, being right at the centre of things in London in the mid-1960s, to go to Buffalo, which is we know Buffalo, and it was a, you know, disaster from a family point of view, and it was America, but it was absolutely not the America he thought he was going to, so there's that, and then he goes to UC Santa Cruz, and you know, I mean, it's a very small school. There's no architecture. He's just teaching art history, so he becomes more of a sort of eccentric peripheral figure.
Yeah.
Continues doing journalism, but there's a sense that at that point he really is on the edge. You know, he's definitely got readers, but he's doing these rather eccentric things. Like Desert's book, In America, Deserter. Is a very strange, very eccentric book. I think it's great, love it. But how
did the sort of broader public, you know, when he was writing for magazines and stuff, you know, what kind of response did he have from the non-architectural public?
Oh, I think he was quite popular. You know, I think the Los Angeles book sold a lot. I don't have figures, but, you know, it's been through many editions. It was a hit. There's a BBC TV program, you know, Reyner Banham Loves Los Angeles, that's been, you know, often broadcast. So I think he becomes this media presence in quite a successful way. Then, you know, in terms of his journalism, he's a very popular part of New Society, and you know, along with, you know, Peter Hall sometimes writing very interestingly on planning for New Society. But it was the Paul Barker, the editor of New Society, that loved him, I think. You know, he was somebody who you could just leave him to write about anything, and he would reliably turn in 700 words about whatever he'd just seen.
Yeah.
And I think he was an important part of that magazine and the production of a liberal left view, but one that was not at all doctrinaire, you know, like a liberal left view that was prepared to say that there might be interesting stuff coming out of the United States, and that, you know, consumer culture might be important in some ways, and there might be things to learn from anything that you come across. So a very pragmatic and open-minded approach. I mean, that, you know, I suppose is where he's one of several areas where he's a difficult figure now.
Right. You know? Now, what is your sense of his relationship to, you know, postmodernism of this 1970s? He died young, right? I mean, he died in the mid-80s. He was pretty, how old was he?
66.
66, yeah, he died young.
Scary, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. What happened?
The cancer, I think it's stomach cancer.
Yeah. What is the relation to, you know, Venturi and learning from Las Vegas and all that stuff?
Yeah, it's a good question. The Nigel Whiteley book goes into postmodernism a lot. Yeah. And one of the things that Whiteley is most interested in is whether Banham is a postmodernist or not.
Right.
Doesn't really reach any conclusions about it. I mean, publicly, Banham was very hostile to postmodernism.
Right.
You know, when he's talking about, like, even very late on, he talks about Johnson's AT&T building, and he can't even regard it as architecture. You know, he sort of says that the ground floors are architecture, but then when it reaches that pediment, then it's just window dressing. So, I mean, in that sense, you know, very often he's ranged against it. Right. And then he writes a very hostile review of David Watkins' book, Architecture and Morality, which takes Watkins to task for the way that he reads Pevsner and says that, you know, he's misunderstood the modern movement and all of that.
Yeah.
And then he has some quite public arguments with Jenks, Charles Jenks, was his PhD student.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny. I mean, so there's all of that. And then at the same time, you read the Los Angeles book, and then, you know, in almost every respect, what he's describing is a postmodern environment, you know,
yeah.
In an early stage, you know, a place that has, you know, no obvious hierarchies. It's, you know, it's a multicultural, it's constantly in flux, and it's fluid. And it reads, you know, like in a very untheoretical way, it sort of reads like French postmodern theory. If not architecture. And then what he's saying about architecture is that he's fascinated by these hamburger stands and roadside restaurants and all of that. You know, that sort of interest is totally postmodern, really. So it's a completely contradictory position. I think he doesn't like the terminology, and he doesn't want to be part of the gang.
I think there is a kind of a split, not a split, a sort of contradiction, complexity and contradiction in postmodernism about this whole, the style of postmodernism as it came about with Charles Jenks and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And even Venturi as an architect, and Venturi, Brown, Scott Brown as architects, versus kind of a little bit of the iconoclasm of learning from Las Vegas, and a slightly carnivalous character to some of those writings, which marries well with Banham's thinking.
Very much, right. Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things where I now want to go back and just read what he said about the Venturis exactly. But my impression is always that, you know, he's quite aligned with them. He's quite well aligned with that that stuff.
Yeah.
I often would teach learning from Las Vegas and Los Angeles in the same class. You know, they're doing quite similar jobs. Yeah. But the postmodernism that evolves in architecture around, you know, as a style with Jenks and whatever, you know, he's very hostile to that. And it's precisely what's going on is not clear. I think there is partly an Oedipal thing going on, you know, if you were going to psychoanalyze him, you know. He's unhappy with Jenks and, you know, the young upstart and
everything. Yeah.
But I think, he does miss something in the, there are things going on in that theorization of postmodernism and in Watkin as well, which are in their sort of reactionary way are quite radical. There's something about that stuff which is in a vanguard at a particular moment, and Banham looks like a rather rear guard figure, who wants to hold at that point, he wants to hold on to the modern.
So we know Banham, the modernist, brutalist, so on, and you've talked about him in LA. Talk a little bit more about him in the desert. And the whole, environmentalist sort of aspect.
No, the desert book is extraordinary. It's not very widely read, I don't think.
Yeah, no, not at all. Yeah.
Published by a strange publisher in Utah. And it's a very odd book. I mean, if you talk to the children about it, Banham's children, I mean, they can't bear reading it because they say it's very personal. It's the book that talks most about Banham himself. It's the one that's most self-reflective about his experiences in the desert. But I think what's really interesting about it is that it draws on some sources, including a book by Charles Doughty on the Arabian desert, but it draws on various existing and quite archaic sources to try to describe a total experience. So I think there is definitely a trajectory in Banham stuff from thinking about small discrete objects, things that you can pick up or whatever, and then increasingly he's interested in environments and then total experiences like the desert. So it's this attempt through a humanistic writing experiment to account for a complete and all-enveloping experience that involves sight and the sensations of temperature and wind, and involves traveling, the sensation of speed, and all of these things, and what happens to perception under these conditions. And so it's like the desert becomes a kind of an object, a kind of work of art in a way, and that it's an experiment in writing. And then it becomes very personal at various points. He kind of then goes back to his childhood in Norwich and talks about the his first experience of a desert condition as being in on a sort of heathland as a child, place that was naturally very dry and often caught fire in the summer, and it goes back to that, and it's just fascinating piece of writing. I think in terms of setting out for a reader like us a series of questions about how you account for a total experience, what kinds of vocabulary you use, how you approach it, how you incorporate a sort of inner experience along with outward perception. Very interesting experiment. And then, the places that he's describing are fascinating. All of them. Some of them are architectural, some of them not.
Detail for people who haven't read the book, what Banham meant by total experience.
I think it's, it's not, that's really my phraseology rather than his, but I think, what I'm getting at is the idea of what it's like to be somewhere, and the being is physical and it's visual and it's experiential in every possible sense, and the sense that you're not bracketing off any perceptions, but you're trying to talk about everything all at the same time. There's something quite ecstatic about it, almost religious. And that is it's a very interesting move, from going in the 1950s, talking about quite discrete objects.
Right.
And then increasingly, talking about larger and larger objects. Almost. Right. And then you end up with something where the objects have just dissolved. You're thinking about the totality.
Right.
There's definitely hints of it in Los Angeles. I think particularly when he's talking about the freeway experience, that's fascinating for me. What he's trying to describe. It's how do you describe the whole experience of driving. Yeah. So very highly idealized, of course. But yeah.
Of course, of course. So, but flipping it all around again. So if Banham is in some ways, as a public intellectual, all about what is hidden in plain sight and the radicality of what is hidden in plain sight, what are you going after? What is your proposition, obsession, rather?
With this particular case, it's the finding, you know, having the license to explore things which are just there, you know, and being open-minded about things to wonder if what if they're all right to talk about, you know, not prejudging things. What if there are things that come out of very, you know, awkward and difficult circumstances, maybe produced by capitalistic or, you know, authoritarian processes that you might not like. But what if once those objects are out in the world, they are used and appropriated and inhabited in different ways? I think I want the license to talk about that stuff. And I particularly want the license to talk about things which are possibly, you know, bad taste or awkward to talk about, things that fall down in polite conversation. But you know, Banham is interesting because he's prepared to do that. Now, I mean, you know, what I have often or increasingly found difficult in teaching is that those habits they're out of step with where we are at the moment, you know. And I mean, Banham does all kinds of things which are, you know, very old fashioned now. Some of his language is, you know, inappropriate. He's not good on gender, you know, the way he talks about it. It's not that bad, but it's also, you know, it's very much of its time.
Sure.
He can't really deal with race, you know, all that stuff. You know, it's still this approach of open-mindedness is important. And I want to hang on to that. So, you know,
why is that important for you? I mean, you certainly do want to go and talk about things that aren't, things that are possibly just ordinary and but also somewhat uncomfortable and which make the conversation drop, like you said. You know, why is that?
Yeah. Well, I don't know whether I can give you an adequate explanation there, but I suppose it's, you know, there's a contrariness, which I think is important to have in the world. You know, you need to have people saying, but what, you know, what about this? You know, are you sure you know what you're talking about? What about this? I think the professional drives for consistency and to have a, you know, consistent narrative that you put out there, I'm more and more resistant to that.
Yeah. You
know, really more and more. That's not why I came into doing this in the first place. Mm. And so Banham is certainly somebody who is impossible to pin down. So it's like a, you know, it's a mode of being that I want to hold on to. I think we need to have a few people around who are not prepared to be consistent and are you know, going to look at things which are, you know, don't reinforce some existing narrative, but are you know, awkward and destabilizing. So I mean, you know, to elaborate that, you know, I mean, here I'm talking from Sao Paulo, and the thing that I'm looking at here,
the worm,
the big worm, is a really awkward object, and it's a 3.5 kilometer long elevated highway, you know, of a kind that you see all over the world.
Yeah.
It's 50 years old. It was built by the military dictatorship in 1969.
Uh-huh.
So it has this really ugly history.
Uh-huh.
And it's right from the beginning, people wanted it demolished. So it's really awkward. And there have been for some years now, you know, plans to do something nice with it, to civilize it.
Yeah.
And, you know, very, very likely at some point, it probably will become something like the High Line.
Get civilized or demolished, like we do in Seattle. We had a beautiful berm here in Seattle, which they got rid of anyway.
So I mean, I'm interested in the fact that at the moment, actually, it has this life where it's really quite a rich place, and that it's become very clear in the local discourse that simply demolishing it and, you know, doing what they did in Boston, even if it could be afforded, would not necessarily be the right thing to do, because it would expel a huge population of people who actually need it to be there, because it keeps the real estate values low enough for them to afford to be there.
Right. Yeah. I mean, yeah. So, I mean, the whole point of clearing out these kind of berms is to improve the real estate values of the adjoining properties.
It's fundamentally about that. So, in fact, there are many voices now who are opposed to getting rid of it, and it's a site of huge contradictions. And I think, unlike other cases outside of Brazil, what's particularly interesting about it is that it holds almost all of these possibilities in play. So it is still a highway to the week, but it's also a park, and it's also a place where hundreds of homeless people live, and it's also this site of, you know, outdoor art exhibitions, and it's a, you know, place of, you know, all sorts of, I mean, you know, semi illegal activities going on, as you can imagine. So it's, you know, all human life is there, you know, it's in microcosm, it's got everything that you need to know about the Brazilian city. But it's, I mean, for me, the attraction of it is in large part the fact that it is such a difficult object. Liberal left dinner party opinion is, you know, of course it's, you know, just demolish it, you know, let's get rid of it, of course it's hideous, how can it possibly be any good? But I'm interested in the possibility of, you know, how you might actually live with these things. Maybe it's not such a bad thing. So I think a larger project that may develop out of this is exploring a series of worms, a series of elevated with interesting cultures around them. I mean, one will probably be the West Way in London. So the A40M, as it cuts into West London, and it has, right from the beginning of its life, it has been the home of all sorts of, you know, fascinating cultures, which would not have come together in that place without this extremely awkward and, you know, ugly bit of infrastructure. Early 70s, it's a place of lots of free concerts, you know, precursors of raves, that sort of thing. It's like the center of the alternative counterculture.
I mean, I'm looking up the worm online as we are talking. Yeah. You know, there are these renderings, you know, greening Sao Paulo's big worm, you know, which sort of highlines it. And what is the amazing thing about this that I was talking, you know, we talk about this again and again, every architectural representation, you know, has all these sunny, white, warm people with pushing babies in strollers, you know. There is no, you never find a architectural representation with include some semi-illegal activities taking place or things like that, or homeless encampments just as such, not improved via the architectural imagination into normalization. So this is a real problem, isn't it? Is this something, you know, the other representation, or you've written about how architecture and cities are represented in film and in other forums?
Yeah, I mean, I'm far from alone in doing that. I mean, there's lots of work doing that. But I think it is still possible to find objects which are, you know, certainly, you know, difficult to locate in art history, which is the discipline that I come out of. And I suppose my students are art history students, so so sometimes I'm talking to architects, but I mean, you know, a lot of the time I'm talking to art history students, and I want them to look at stuff that maybe, you know, destabilizes or troubles their understanding of what art history is. So, I mean, I often want to show them something where they will say, you know, why are we looking at this? This isn't art. I mean, I love it when they do that. But now we can start. Now we can do some work. Why shouldn't we look at this?
Yeah.
And take it back to Banham. You know, what one of the reasons for looking at Banham and, you know, telling a new generation of art history students about him is that he's great at doing that. You know, he really expands the definition of what art history might be. And like I say, art history because he was an art historian. That was his, you know, he was at the Courtauld, and despite all the architecture, he was basically an art historian.
I wanna turn as we move, start moving towards the end over here to Brazil and your ongoing relationship with Brazil, right? I mean, of course, you did the Reaction series book on Brazil modernism, your book on, you know, I remember you were interested in sex and Brazil.
That doesn't sound good at all.
No, I mean, well, I don't know what I mean, but in the writings, you know, you I remember us having a conversation. And now you're back in Brazil. You know, you were describing Brazil as this almost future. You know what's your why Brazil? Well, you know, is it as far from Edinburgh and Scotland's cold that you can get, or what's going on here?
I don't know. I felt I hadn't finished. There was a period, I suppose the early 2000s, when we first met. Then I spent a few years doing this work, and it was something where, you know, still there are very few Anglophone art historians doing that work. Virtually none. I mean, there are so few of them. And it was possible to carve out some new territory there. But I think I wanted to go in the first place because it seemed to have it was a place that had a different approach to the modern than Britain, right? Or, you know, the Anglophone world, but more broadly. You know, it hadn't been through, didn't seem to have been through the same sort of, you know, crisis about modernity that seemed to affect the Northern Hemisphere. So I wanted to see something different. I mean, that's the only way I could rationalize it. But then I think over the years, it's always been an interesting place to think with. You know, it's a place that represents all sorts of global tendencies, but it rather exaggerates them. And it shows the limits of what architecture can do. But it also shows, you know, just how rich and complex the built environment can be, you know, almost when the situation is impossible to organize, you know. So that's always been...
But why is Brazil particularly of interest in that way to you?
Well, I mean, there's a pragmatics about it, but I think it is certainly in the big cities. So, I mean, Sao Paulo and Rio and to an extent Brasilia, you have for a time, you know, an extraordinary period of urban growth, you know, probably the fastest urban growth in the 20th century for quite a long period. And then you have, at the same time as that, you have what is in many ways an unusually self-conscious architectural profession that's producing a lot of writing and you know, theorizing it and, you know, worrying about it, throwing ideas out there. And it's extremely rich. There's lots of stuff to read and think about. On the one hand, you've got you have modernists like Oscar Niemeyer and the whole Brasilia adventure and all of that, right, and this highly sort of romanticized take on modernism. And there's all sorts of stuff that's interesting about that. And then, you know, the other end, you've got architects in Sao Paulo like Villanova Artigas, who is doing stuff where he's saying, you know, Brazil is a terrible place, and, you know, we need a revolution, and you know, architecture has to be, you know, really conscious of its limits. And then in between those positions, you've got all sorts of other stuff going on. And I think that the way that it's structured economically, the fact that it consistently and repeatedly produces so much informal development, favela, means that it's a place that you are just unusually conscious of the limits of what formal and official architectural practice can do. And it's like, you know, it exists as a kind of question mark. I mean, there, of course, many other places do this, but I think that there's something about Brazil where it has long traditions of thinking about this and being unusually conscious of it. And you know, there's so much good writing that it's produced, you know, virtually none of which has been translated into English or to be better known. So, I mean, I have the all of these ideas I think are translatable into wider contexts, and I would you know, obviously what I'm doing is partly that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, you can't do everything. You've got to focus a bit.
Well, you're certainly trying, Richard. You're such a diverse palette of things that you do, and that's and this iconoclastic approach that you have is exactly the thing that I admire in the work that you do. And in many ways, I worry about this constantly in my career. You know, I work on so many diverse, different things, and you know, I always fret that, you know, where is the unification of all of this?
And yeah.
It just isn't one.
No, I think that's fine. But we need to have these conversations to remind ourselves that it is fine.
Yeah.
The institutional structures out there want you to.
Yeah, have a single voice and a mission and a sort of broad agenda.
You have a pitch. You know, you've got your pitch. And I think also, you know, one thing I would say about Brazil is that there's definitely, there are pressures out there that would, you know, make you question whether you have the authority to talk about it. I mean, like, obviously, you know, you can talk about Chandigarh with a special sort of authority because you are of it, you know, mm-hmm. and, you know, you're right inside it. And I, somebody could reasonably say, you know, what are you doing there? You know, you're not of this place. You know, there are limits to your mm-hmm. ability to deal with this stuff. And I'm, you know, acutely aware of, you know, some language issues and stuff.
Right.
But I still think it's defensible. But I think, you know, as long
absolutely.
As you're, you know, I think you know, because I'm not, my perspective is absolutely not that of I don't think it is a sort of colonial perspective at all. I mean, in fact, if anything else, what I want to do with it is to put the Brazilian experience at the center of a global history. Because I think there are things.
This is a persistent white post-colonial anxiety. Mm. You know, I always find this running across people writing about these other sites. Mm. I mean, I sort of belong to middle upper class India. I'm not sure I have a real perspective on India from a subaltern or even ground, you know, lower class perspective. Yeah. So anyway, that's it's not just it. What I was trying to get about was not just this issue of legitimacy, if you like, but what I am fascinated by what you do is how you, like Banham, get into so many different things and keep so many different balls in the air and just do it.
I think it only looks like that, Vikram. When you look at what people have been doing, sometimes it, you know, it looks like there's more actually going on than there is. But there we are. But you have to keep interested, don't you? You've got to.
Well, it's part of our personas and sort of, I guess, production of public intellectuality to keep that appearance going. So that's great. Thanks for being on my podcast again, Richard. Cannot wait for your new book. I want to know more about the work. So
yeah, well, you will. I think there will be an article out before there's a book, but we'll see. I'm hoping to get something out fairly soon.
Sounds good.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Architecture Talk. This is your producer, Amelia Jarvinen. We hope you enjoyed the conversation, and if you did, please subscribe and rate us on iTunes or Spotify. We would also love to hear from you if you have any suggestions on new topics or guests. You can always reach out to us on our website, Facebook, or Instagram. Thanks again, and until next time, this is Architecture Talk.